Father God, we ask you to intervene on this broadcast, Lord. We are back. We are back. Okay, I'm believing really mighty, mighty things tonight. The Lord is just really, really moving. Hi, Carissa. Hi, welcome. Welcome to tonight. That the Holy Spirit's presence moving over you in your home tonight as we release some things that the Lord has been speaking, as we release, the fear that you gain faith. And so we're going to hone in on fear, on faith, and on thirst tonight. Is it freezing on your end? Because it is here.
Yeah, it is.
Is it, James? Can you go see if John is doing something? Yes. Okay. I'm not going to start until it's done. Sometimes it takes just a couple minutes, so we're just going to wait a minute here, and then we're going to carry on like we always do, and nothing's stopping us. Just hang out. Fear, faith, and thirst. We're going to usher in the presence of the Lord through a prayer right now, and then we're going to just dive right into what I believe, what God wants to speak to you. It's not freezing now. Okay, great. Sometimes it does that the first couple minutes. It's okay, right? Because God reigns, he has it, and he wants his word put out. Amen. So, Father God, right now we pray for your hand over this broadcast. Lord, we usher in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask that the Holy Spirit be made manifest upon the people that are watching now and the people that are going to play this replay. Lord, we ask for a special anointing over the prophetic words that will go forth tonight. We ask for an anointing over your word that you are speaking. Lord, I ask that everything that is spoken through me as a vessel is straight from heaven in the name of Jesus. We ask for fresh new revelation. Lord, in Jesus' mighty name, we command a nice, big, fresh drink of water. A drink of water tonight for all who are thirsty and who are hungry for the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, take us swimming in your streams, Lord. Water us. Water us like you do your precious trees. Water us, Lord. We pray that the roots from these trees are taking root, that are spreading. In Jesus' name, Lord, we worship you. We worship you. Amen. Thanks, Daisy Pearl. Kathy, hi. Nice to see you. Nice to see you. Okay, so the Lord has shared some things with me that we are going to bring to light. And then we're going to press on towards the word. And we were on the broadcast the other day because I felt the Lord was really, really strong here in my home, where he said, pray for the 20s and the 30-year-olds at this time. There was almost like something was just happening. I just knew that something was going on. So we ushered in the presence of the Holy Spirit the other night, and we prayed over, everybody's kids. Maybe they were just people that you knew, and the prophetic word came forth, and it was just absolutely beautiful. So Lord, we thank you. We thank you for quickening us to come into an alignment with you, co-laboring with you in such ways, Lord. And so, I'm going to lay a foundation here tonight, and we're going to talk about fear, faith, and thirst. Amen. And what is prompting this discussion is a vision that the Lord gave me a few days ago, and it was a vision of a spigot from a sink, and the spigot was not turned out on, it was just dry. And I believe the Lord was speaking to me, because I'm constantly in prayer, Lord, what do your people need in this hour? What do they need? Because I don't want to teach from my own strength. I don't want to teach from my own mind. I want to bring you what the Lord sees that needs in your home. And he's telling me, Michelle, the people are thirsty. They're thirsty. Now, I'm going to share with you what the Bible says about being thirsty. I'm also going to take you down a path that reveals how one becomes dehydrated, right? How you become dehydrated of the things of the Lord. And so we're going to start with John chapter 7, verse 37. And Jesus is talking, okay? And Jesus tells the people, he says, now on the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Jesus stands among the crowd and he says, anybody who is thirsty, let him come to me for a drink. He is not talking about physical water. He is talking about a thirst and a hunger for something new, for something greater, for something better. And he has that. He has the word. He has what he speaks. He has his healing. We have the holy word. When we are thirsty and we are tired of the things of the world, right? Because the things of the world weigh on our shoulders, and all of the sin that is around us in the world comes onto us on our shoulders. We become very thirsty. We become very weary in our spirit. We become very even depressed. And the Lord stands among the people. He says, come, you all who are weary, I will give you rest. He says that in the Bible, but he also says, come all who are thirst, I will give you a drink. And so tonight, Lord, we are ushering in everybody in this broadcast and the people that are in a replay. Lord, we long to drink from your cup, Lord. We ask that you take away the cups of the world, the things that have been feeding us garbage, the things that are dehydrating our spirits. And we ask you right now to do a supernatural redo, to do a supernatural remove of the things of the world that are not of you, Lord. And we want to partake of you, Jesus, tonight, of your cup and of your divine nature. In Jesus' name, Isaiah 44:3 says, for I will pour out water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour out my spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. So, Lord, we ask for that water. We ask for your streams to come flowing through our homes, through our bedrooms, through our kids' rooms. We're asking you that our land, Lord, we are telling you that our land is thirsty at this time and hour. We ask you to release from the throne room, Lord, fresh anointing, fresh oil, fresh water, fresh streams. And you said that you will pour your spirit on your offspring. We ask for a fresh outpour of the Holy Ghost tonight over your offspring. Lord, you said, your word says, Lord, over the offspring and my blessing on your descendants. Lord, we are holding on to the word that is in the Bible, Isaiah 44:3, that you shower our descendants with your spirit. And this hour, we ask that you quicken this, that you hurry this up, Lord, that there is not a waiting period. They are weary, Lord. People are weary. They are weary. We ask that you remove that and infiltrate the streams in their homes, quicken them to pick up the holy word and to turn off the news media, to shut down the noise, to deafen their ears to the chaos of the things of the world. We command that in the name of Jesus. Keep us on the path of righteousness and right standing with you, Lord. Amen. Perfect love of the Father, perfect love of the Father casts out all fear. Fear causes thirst. Fear is part of a sin nature of man that makes one thirsty. One thing that I wrote down today that is a quote from Bill Johnson, and he said when he was 18 years old, he got a prophetic word and it has never left him. And that prophetic word was, if you long for me like I long for you. This is Jesus talking. If you long for me like I long for you, you will be satisfied. If you long for me like I long for you, you will be satisfied. You will be far from oppression because you will have no fear. Fear causes oppression. That is scripture. You will be far from oppression because you will have no fear. Okay, when you have fear, it brings you into an oppressive state. It joins you with something that's not of God, making one become thirsty because you don't feel God's presence around you. And even Jesus experienced this, and I can hardly read the scripture without being in tears, but we're going to get through it tonight because I think that it's very important. We're going to base this entire broadcast off of John chapter 19, 28. So if you want to go to the book of John chapter 19, verse 28, what I want you to remember and keep in mind is Jesus has just now said, all who are weary or all who are thirsty, come to me and I will give them a drink. Jesus, that's a command. If you're thirsty, come to me, I'll give you a drink. Now, here's what Jesus says as he's hanging on the cross. The man who said to come to him, if you're thirsty, I will give you a drink. Remove yourself from the things of the world. Remove yourself from the sin nature around you and drink of my divine nature. His divine nature, when you drink of it, gives you a direct access to the things of God, to the things of the Holy Spirit, to the operation thereof and the gifts of the Spirit. Amen. Jeff, it's frozen. It's not frozen on my end, buddy. It's working perfectly fine. I was waiting for you to come back. I figured it out. Welcome back. Welcome back, Paula. Okay, is it freezing on anybody else? Because on my end, I got good stuff going on here. Good stuff. John chapter 19, verse 28. And let's read this together. John 19:28. Now Jesus is hanging on the cross at this point. Okay, this is after he's standing amongst the people saying, come to me, you know, all who are thirst. It's talked about in the book of Isaiah. We talk about streams, wells, the woman at the well. If you knew who you were giving a drink to, a lot of reference in the Bible with water and Holy Spirit has to do with the regeneration of your soul. Okay, the regeneration of your soul. Okay, John chapter 19, verse 29, or 28. And it reads, later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty. Now Jesus is thirsty. He's thirsty. He's hanging on the cross. And it says later, knowing that everything had now been finished, then it says, and so that scripture would be fulfilled. And so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty. Scripture for prophecy to be fulfilled, Jesus had to take this last drink. It was the last act that he did before he gave his spirit up. It's the last act. Why did Jesus say, I'm thirsty, and do this last prophetic act? I'm going to tell you why. And it is fulfilled prophecy. He had to do it before sending his spirit up to the Lord, before sending his spirit up to God. Verse 29, a large jar of wine vinegar was there. Just happened to be there, right? A large jar of wine vinegar was there. So they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus's lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. With that, he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. This is a prophetic act that had to be done, okay? And the people doing it don't know it has to be done. They didn't say, leave a jar there of wine and vinegar so that we can give this to Jesus before he passes. They had a reason why they gave it to him. And I'm going to show you in a couple of scriptures. And so before I explain to you the hyssop plant, why he became thirsty and why he had to give him a drink, I got to show you one more scripture, and it's Mark 15:34. Mark chapter 15, 34. And it says, let's go to 33. It reads, at noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of those standing near heard this, they said, listen, he's calling Elijah. So let me paint this scene here for you, okay? Because we're looking at two accounts, what happens while Jesus is hanging on the cross. And then you're going to get a good picture about thirst, okay? Why we're thirsty, why Jesus was thirsty. Jesus is taking away the sins of the world. While he's on that cross, literally every sin, every sickness, every disease, every foul thing that rested on this earth was slapped on Jesus on that cross. So Jesus crucified on the cross is hanging there, and all of sin is on him. And he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because God is holy and he cannot look at sin. Okay, which is why you couldn't get in the temple courts. You couldn't part the veil and go into the place of Holy of Holies because of sin. Sin cannot reside where God lives. So at that point in time, because Jesus had taken on the complete sin nature of man, he feels the weightiness and he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? He felt the pull away of his father. It's the first time ever that God is disconnected from his son. And at that point, Jesus cries out, I thirst. Do you understand the connection? The weightiness from our nation, the weightiness from this virus, the weightiness from the politics, the weightiness from the news media. It's all of the sin nature of man that starts to cover you and gets into the depths of your soul and you feel a disconnect from your God. Did God leave you? No. He says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. But the weightiness of the yuck resides on you and you can't help it. Therefore, you begin to thirst. Amen. You begin to thirst. So now you come into a place where you don't go to the places that are desert walks. You don't go into places that are dry. You don't walk into the places that are of the wilderness. Be informed about what's going on around you, but do not partake in their cup. Partake in the cup of Christ. Drink from the cup of his Holy Spirit. Have divine appointments with him. To drink of the cup of our Savior is to water yourself in the Word of God, to pick up your Bible, to water yourself as a tree, okay? To water yourself as a tree. Now I'm going to share with you the hyssop branch and the wine that was with the vinegar. Now that might sound, what a horrible thing to give him a sponge with wine and vinegar. But at that point in time, that was actually a really, really nice gesture. They would give wine and vinegar was given to the laborers and to the soldiers at that time because it relieved them of thirst more effectively. Something about the vinegar and the wine together quenched their thirst, so they weren't thirsty anymore. Amen. And we have the wine that is a beautiful representation of a type of Holy Spirit. It's a type of, you know, new wine. The grapes, we read a lot about Holy Spirit and wine in scriptures. And he's fulfilling a prophetic act, yet they do not even realize that. So I'm going to read to you the prophetic act and the prophecy that is given beforehand, where Jesus, this is part of the fulfilled prophecy. Another reason why they wanted to give him this wine and this vinegar is because people started talking around him after he cries out and he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? All of a sudden, the people standing around, they say, is he talking to Elijah? Is Elijah coming back? Because the Jews are waiting for Elijah to come back. And so many believe that they give him this water and vinegar as a means to keep him alive a little bit longer on the cross, okay, so that they can see if Elijah return, okay? So that's another thing out there. I don't know how hold true that is, but it is something that I did read in a concordance. And then, of course, we have a Mark chapter 14, verse 22, where Jesus sitting with his disciples right before he goes up on the cross, and they're having their Passover meal, and Jesus has the cup of wine, and they pass that one cup around, and he says, do this in remembrance of me. The cup of the wine is a representation of the blood that was shed. And so tonight we will read that scripture. We're going to drink of Holy Communion. We're going to drink of the cup. He says, flesh of my flesh, bone of my bone. He says, you know, to even eat my flesh at one point in the scriptures, and the disciples are like, ooh, that's so gross. But let me tell you how divine that is of our Lord to say such things. So let's take you to, I'm going to read you a couple of things. You don't have to go there, but I am going to read you Psalms 51. Now, this is all regarding the hyssop branch that they sent up to Jesus with the wine on it. The hyssop branch is a very, very important piece of scripture because the hyssop plant was used for cleansing. Okay, and because this hyssop plant is used with the wine vinegar, this is part of a cleansing and a purification process before he releases his spirit up to the Lord. Blood is always shed, hyssop is produced, and we're going to read that. I'm going to read you one scripture from Psalms, and I'm going to carry you to Exodus and Leviticus so that you can see how hyssop and blood connect together with the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior to the point where he says, I thirst. Okay, so let's read Psalms chapter 51, verse 7. And this is David. He's talking, and this is a psalm of repentance. And he says, cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. So that shows you there that hyssop was clean, was to be clean. Now I'm going to take you to Leviticus, and we're going to go to chapter 14, and we're going to go to verse 33. You know what? We're not going to go there yet. Let's go to Leviticus 14, 1 through 7. And this is Lord, the Lord is teaching Moses how to cleanse people from diseases, from defiling things. When people would get sick, when they would get diseased, they would have to be escorted out of the camp and they would be taken somewhere else. And in order to come back into the residence, to come back into the camp, the priest had to check them over. They had to anoint them with oils. And this whole procedure and process had to take place. Keep in mind that anything that is talking about sickness and disease is also discussing sin. Sin and sickness go hand to hand. Anything you would not find in the Garden of Eden, which you wouldn't find sickness and disease, or you wouldn't find in heaven, is going to be straight from another source, which is from our adversary. And so let's read chapter 14, 1 through 7. And then I'm really excited to share this with you because It's going to tie a lot of loose ends together, especially with the trees that we have been talking about. So just have a listening ear right now and put in your memory bank these scriptures that are being downloaded from the Holy Word to you right now. Father God, we ask for retention on the other line, that the ears are wide open for the Holy Word, that you actually have little, almost like shelves in place in your minds and your memory banks where they can categorize all of these scriptures and no seed may be stolen, Lord. We ask for you to begin sowing your nature in their mind, sowing fresh new revelations as the word is being brought forth in the mighty name of Jesus. Okay, so Leviticus 14. I'm going to read to you 7 verses. The Lord said to Moses, "These are the regulations for any diseased person at the time of their ceremonial cleansing when they are brought to the priest." How many of you know Jesus is the high priest? Okay, that's all through the Testament. He is the new high priest. The priest is to go outside the camp and examine them. If they've been healed of their defiling skin disease, the priest shall order that 2 live clean birds and some cedar wood, scarlet yarn, and hyssop be brought for the person to be cleansed. Then the priest shall order that one of the birds be killed over fresh water in a clay pot. He is then to take the live bird and dip it, together with the cedar wood and scarlet yarn and hyssop, into the blood of the bird that was killed over the fresh water. Listen to all of the prophetic innuendos: the fresh water, the blood of the bird, the scarlet yarn, which is red, the hyssop. 7 times he shall sprinkle the one to be cleansed of the defiling disease and then pronounce them clean. 7 times they are sprinkling this blood from this bird on this person from this defiling disease over a clay pot. Clay pots in the prophetic and clay pots in the Bible represent new creation, new mold. I'm making you out of clay, okay? And so all of this together is a prophetic act that is being done. Once they do this with this dead bird, they release the other bird to fly away. This is the same thing that they did with Christ before he was crucified on the cross. They released Barnabas, a mass murderer, from jail as a scapegoat before Jesus was crucified. Whenever you read, you'll always see scapegoats that are released as ones being sacrificed. Okay, so it's the same prophetic act happening over and over and over again. So we read about it in the book of Leviticus, and you'll also read about it in the book of Exodus. And so we have the same God today as we had, you know, yesterday. And I just thank the Lord that we don't have to go through these prophetic acts no more anymore, because Jesus bridged that gap and he was that ultimate sacrifice. And so now we have this divine access right to him, and we need not shed no blood because he already did that on a cross, slapping all sin nature on that cross, so that when we are born again, we have Jesus's divine nature inside of us to use for direct access to the Father. Amen. So if you go to Leviticus chapter 12, verse 22, it reads, "Take a bunch of hyssop, dip it into the blood in the basin, and put some of the blood on the top and on both sides of the door frame. None of you should go out of the door of your house until morning." This was to protect the people from the plagues that were coming, from all the plagues that was set among Egypt. Put the blood on the door frames to keep the death angel from coming and getting them in their homes. And they use hyssop branches to do it. Amen. And so I thought that that was a really, really incredible thing that the Lord was speaking, because Jesus thirst when he was separated from his Father. Okay. What separates us from God, even though he's always there, he'll never leave you nor forsake you, is this. If we're not picking this up and we're reading it and we only wait for a Monday night broadcast, or if we only wait for a Sunday night, you know, church or whatever it is that you engage in, this is something that is a divine connection and access with our Lord and Savior daily. Just as we drink daily, we should be watering ourselves with the Word of God. As we water ourselves, the Lord is able to water us through His Word. It's an amazing download from heaven. Absolutely an amazing download. And so, the blood on the hyssop branch actually purified the person. And so we have Jesus that had already shed the blood, okay? And we have the hyssop branch that they just put the wine and the vinegar on. And the hyssop plant was used during the Jewish Passover. It had a cleansing effect with plagues, leprosy, and it was a symbolic and cleansing to the soul. So this was something that they did during Jewish Passover, and Jesus was a Jew. So this would have been a prophetic act that they would have performed while he was hanging on the cross. It is mentioned six times in the Bible. You'll hear about this. And the natural remedies, if you were to get a hold of some hyssop here now, you can use the natural remedies. They're for asthma, stomach issues, gas indigestion, colic, and it actually has antibacterial properties. And so hyssop is a very, very amazing all-natural plant that God has, you know, set aside for us. I'm going to take you now into a new area, and then we're going to start to connect the dots, because before you get off this broadcast, the Lord no longer wants you thirsty. Okay, He no longer wants you thirsty. He's turning on the spigot tonight. He's already started turning it. Okay, it's not just dripping. We are asking for a full flood over this broadcast, for a full cleansing, for the angels to usher in Lord Jesus some hyssop and sprinkle it amongst the people on the other end, Lord. We ask you, Lord, and give you free reign to do whatever you need to do for the viewers on the other end, for emotional healing, mental healing, for sustainability, for strength. Father God, teach them the ways that they have direct access to you, and your divine nature rests inside everybody on this broadcast. We're going to talk about that next Monday. Jesus's divine nature inserted in you and what that looks like. That will be next week. But right now, I'm going to share with you, did you guys see the video of our Christmas tree? That our Christmas tree is still alive. It's still thriving. It has no root system. There are no brown spots. It's still drinking. We're watering this thing every single day, and we cut it down the day after Thanksgiving. The day after Thanksgiving, we cut this tree down. I call it our tree of righteousness that is in our home. And, you know, it's just a beautiful picture of what God can do with a tree even that has no roots. Okay? And I believe that He's talking to many people that feel like they haven't established a foundation. Therefore, how could they have a healthy, thriving tree? How could they bring people into the kingdom and their family when they never raised them up in the kingdom? Where do we go from here? If I'm made brand new, almost like people feel like it's too late. And I'm here to tell you, brothers, sisters, and saints, that it is never too late. We have seen amazing miracles by God where He does a redo right on the spot. And He can transform anybody within just through prayer, within a second of a prayer. But Psalms chapter 1, verse 1 reads, "Blessed is the one who does not walk in the step with wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but who delight is in the law of the Lord, who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Notice that David is saying in this book of Psalms that they meditate on the law day and night. That would be the word. That would be the word. So the Bible says that you as a tree will be watered as you are reading the word of God. Okay? Those who are thirsty because they're busy. All right? And I'm not here to condemn you, condone you. We don't have a God that does that. But we do have a God that brings awareness for healing in your leaves. Amen. Okay. We have a Father that corrects us when we get off the beaten path. And he puts us back on a path. Wouldn't it be wonderful if he puts us back on a path through a lovely video, and he doesn't put us on a path another way like he did back in the Old Testament, how he had to teach his sons and daughters, okay? And so there is a quickening happening. There is a paradigm shift that is happening in the world right now, a huge paradigm shift. And we don't have time to get in it tonight, but I can tell you from prophetically speaking and through the dreams and visions that are happening now, you ain't seen nothing yet. And there is a very big paradigm shift happening. You've got to stay close to your Father. You've got to stay close into the Word of God and just open it and start reading it and ask the Lord to speak to you in a fresh new way. Ask the Lord to water you every single day. It's very, very important. So that chapter in the book of Psalms talks about reading the Word of God. And then if you go to Jeremiah, the book of Jeremiah also talks about trees. 17:5-8, and it says, this is what the Lord says: cursed is the one who trusts in man. Cursed is the one who trusts in man, that would be news media, who draws strength from mere flesh and whose heart turns away from the Lord. Cursed is the one who relies on man, that rely on man's flesh instead of listening to the Lord. Okay? That's very, very, very big deal. This is the Lord speaking. Okay? And he says cursed is that person. He's not cursing you, but a curse comes upon one, okay, that is soaking and swimming in the areas the Holy Spirit does not reside. Amen? And so he goes on to say, that person will be like a bush in the wastelands. They will not see prosperity when it comes. A bush in a wastelands is dead. It's thirsty. It has not had water. They will not see prosperity when it comes. They will dwell in the parched places of the desert. Mind you, you are on a group called Oasis. The purpose of this group, Oasis, is to build you up, to bring you out of a victimized state, to march boldly and bravely in Christ, to access him noontime, morning time, nighttime, at all times, because you have authority over everything on earth. Okay, and if we are too tired and depleted and thirsty and dehydrated, we cannot access what is rightfully ours because we are too weighed down. And the Lord says that you basically bring a curse on yourself. They would dwell in the parched places of desert, in a salt land where no one lives. But blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit. In other words, this tree has the utmost faith. It never worries when there's a drought. It doesn't worry when the news media says something. It doesn't worry because our kids are doing something that, you know, is contrary to what we have taught them. It doesn't worry. It says that if you remain in trust, if you trust in the Lord, you will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream, and it does not fear when the heat comes, and its leaves are healing. They have healing power in their leaves. How are you guys all doing? Because this is really, really heavy stuff. It's very, very important stuff, because I believe that everybody in this group is a tree planted along the stream, and the stream that was by your tree has run dry. Okay? And so how many of you are with me that you are going to put yourself on a Bible plan? Okay? And I even thought about, you know, getting up in the morning and doing maybe a 10-minute or 15-minute video for 30 days. And then I thought, you know, that would be nice, but I feel like there's an accountability and a responsibility on discipleship and on your part. Maybe if you put yourself on some kind of reading plan with the Lord, or maybe just learn one book. But it is very, very important that you get those streams flowing, because there is a paradigm shift. It's coming, okay? It just is. It has to, for God to reign and undo all of the stuff that has been happening. The Lord did speak something mighty to me this morning in regards to the Black community. And that might sound, you know, very harsh to say, but they're Black, okay? Culturally speaking, all right, of color, whatever. But they're going to be getting hit hard. And I don't know what for or what of, but there's going to be a rise where the Blacks have to start protecting themselves. We have to be full of water to pray for these people and to be, you know, intercessor prayer warriors for other people. It's really, really, really important. We have to keep our water full, okay? And not just for us, but for the sake of our families, for the sake of things that haven't happened yet, and, you know, for the sake of the kingdom, because the kingdom of God is at hand. It's in your hand. It's inside you. You are walking power portals of the kingdom of God. The Bible says the Great Commission to go out, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, heal the sick, freely receive what I've given you, and you freely give it. You are not to watch this video and house everything that you are watching. You are to give it, freely receive, and freely give, and freely fill up your stream, fill up your tank. Holy Spirit, right now, we command in the mighty name of Jesus an infilling tonight like none other. Lord, we will not stand for an inch. We will not stand for knee deep. We are asking for a full, 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 a full infilling, Lord, of an uprise of the Holy Spirit that has been buried in many tonight. We ignite the flame, we ignite the fire, and we ask you to draw the well and bring the well up. Cisterns, I get the word cisterns. If you know what a cistern is, I hope I'm saying it right, but what a cistern is, it's about 1 mile long, and a cistern catches all of the water that comes in naturally. It catches all the water. It's 1 mile long, and it reserves it for times of drought. So we're going to ask the Lord that we have
reservoirs, that we have cisterns, that when we start to get depleted, that we have an extra supply. Let's ask the Lord tonight for an extra supply of water. Lord, we ask that right now, that everybody has cisterns, because they're so full, Lord, of what you're about to pour out tonight, that we need a reservoir. We need retention for all the water that you're going to give tonight. We ask you, Lord, Holy Spirit, right now, that you quicken the people on the other end, that they're not too tired to lift the word of God, that they reorganize their life, that there is an alignment in place, that they organize and balance you in their life, that you are at the forefront of their mind. We ask that chaos dissipate in the name of Jesus. Lead them, Lord, on the path that they should go. We command that they do not go to the right or to the left, but they stay straight, girded and footed in truth. Lord, we ask that they put on their armor, the full armor of God, from head to toe, and they do it on their own, that they are soldiers for you that know how to fight. Teach them how to equip themselves, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, amen. We pray over your tree. We pray over the leaves, and that you start to take root. Root that starts to sprout volunteer trees, people. Roots that start to sprout volunteer trees, that you're going to create your own forest in the kingdom. Something that people has never even seen before, because you have such a thirst, such a hunger, such an infilling from the throne room of God. You have full access behind that 4-inch thick curtain, okay? Use your access that's behind that curtain. Go to it. Run to it. Become a God chaser in this time, in this hour. Seek him, seek him, seek him. Okay? We're going to go ahead and we're going to do Holy Communion together. And we are going to read Mark 14, chapter 14, verse 22. Man, I feel the Holy Ghost tonight is really, really strong here in my room. Oh, it feels so good. So good. Okay. Mark 14:22. This is Jesus at the Last Supper that he has with his disciples. We're going to do this together, so make sure that you have a juice and a bread. I'm going to wait just a minute, because if you're on and you don't have it, you're going to want to go get it. I believe that this is going to be a huge new start for many people that are watching this video, a new redo. Those who have, you know, just backslid a little, and we all do it. The Lord is putting you right back in line. He's putting you on the front lines, okay, so that you can be a great leader, a great mentor. All right. So go ahead and get yourself, you know, the sentiment of your choice. I'm going to look at this. Real quick, what do you see? There's a strong glow in this room, Michelle. There's a glowing crush on your forehead, and it's beautiful sight. That is my ring light, Jeff. It's my light. You know, it's for the clarity of the picture. I can actually see it, but that's from the light. Oh, but I'll take it. Okay. Chapter 14, verse 22. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples. Now, he broke it. That's significant, because his body was badly beaten for us, and this bread is symbolic that he broke it. But you do need to know that no bones were broken on Jesus. That's really significant, and that's a whole nother discussion. But he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, he said to them. Truly I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God. When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. So they sang together. Him and his disciples sang a hymn together. Then they went out to the Mount of Olives. And at that point, that's where Jesus is praying. And he's praying so hard that he's sweating blood. He's praying so hard that he's sweating blood because he foresees what's ahead. Can you even imagine? Okay. And so, you know, we are going to give thanks. And Father God, we just thank you. We thank you for your body that broke. So I'm going to ask you on the other end to go ahead and break yours in half. All right. We thank you, Lord, for us to be alive in this time to partake in such divine nature, your divine nature. We thank you for the new covenant that you have with us. We thank you that we can come to you with all of our sins. And so right now, I want you to repeat after me on the other line. We just say, Dear Jesus, we ask for forgiveness for all of our sins, for the thoughts that enter our mind that are not healthy. Lord, we want to make you proud of us. We know that he loves us, but we just want to make you proud of us, Lord. We ask that you remove all sin from us, and we ask for full forgiveness. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Jeff, you said, no, that's not what I see. What? Oh, because if it's this, I promise you, it's my light. Oh, amen. Thank you, Lord. My husband and I have up and coming news to share with you soon. So I'm excited about that. And we're just happy about, you know, what God is doing with this ministry. It's just neat. It's just neat to see what he's doing with this ministry and, you know, where it's going. And so soon my husband and I are going to be releasing a live video to you all about some new things that are coming into play. But I thank you for joining in on this broadcast, and I pray that it blessed you so much. And next week, we're going to talk about the access into the throne room of God, because to get this access, you need pipeline. Okay, you need pipeline. And what's in that pipeline is more water. Okay, so stay tuned for next week, and I'll see you next Monday at 8 o'clock. And remember, get yourself a Bible reading plan, because of this paradigm shift at this time. Start getting in the Word, and you got to water yourself. You have to take accountability and responsibility for being a disciple of Christ. Do your walk with him. It's your walk and your walk alone. Amen. 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 And thank you. You're welcome, Gigi. You're very welcome. Okay. I will see you guys next week. God bless you. You have sweet dreams. Bye.